My name is Kapil Maheshwari. I'm CEO for Hinduja Renewables. Just a brief background, I'm in solar field for almost 13, 14 years. Started my career as a design engineer in US and in solar. But so many things have been talked, and even I have been speaking on various conferences on solar, CapEx, OpEx, rooftop, utility, price trends, etc., etc. I think it's now time that we go on, move to some other things which are looking more futuristic rather than talking about the same kind of things. Because even in some of the EQ conferences, I have spoken on rooftop, utility system, what are the challenges, what are the opportunities. So I thought, let me share with you some of the things which we have been working on for almost a year's time. And of course, this is not the part where our work summary is, but just an overview of, because energy storage would be the factor which will drive renewable towards 100 gigawatt mission. I mean, there's no way we can do 100 gigawatt, even if as in solar industry, we are ready to do. We have seen globally that what happens with California duck curve, with various other things. So unless we have storage in various forms, and not only maybe batteries, but other forms, it is very difficult that we will be able to get to that mark. And of course, we've started, maybe there are off-grid application, telecom towers, maybe there are microgrids wherein batteries are used, but now it's time that it's now at a scale where we can use it in most of our systems as well. And like the way pricing trends have been spoken about solar panels, pricing trends, the most recent pricing trends would be on the lithium-ion batteries, where globally these are being talked about, to how the pricing trends are coming. What's the readiness for companies in India? I mean, at least in recent conferences, I have met at least 10 startups who want to set up lithium-ion battery packs in India. So where do we stand on that? Let me just start with what's the overall energy technology looks like. I mean, you have various factors to what are the various storage types. Is hydrogen related, where you want to use hydrogen as a fuel? So it could be in cars, it could be. So let me just divide the presentation. In this presentation, I'm not speaking on the electric vehicle front of it, because that will be the major contributor for the battery technology. Stationary storage, what I am covering here, which is largely matches with our conference agenda today, which is renewable plus in storage. But the major contribution would come on this from the electric vehicles. Then there are mechanical storage, electrochemical, where we have been talking on the battery technology, electrical and thermal. So like supercapacitors, magnetic energy storage, what are these is you can store a lot of energy in this and discharge it in seconds. So let's say primarily useful in a bus which wants to get charged very soon on a route, or maybe in train, such kind of application, supercapacitors. Then we have batteries, where it's in between in terms of its power rating and the amount of discharge it can give. So it can, you know, give you a discharge from couple of minutes to couple of hours. And various technologies could be lithium ion, lead acid. I mean, we still have a market in India for lead acid of around, let's say, 8-10 gigawatt hours. But does that, you know, whatever said and done, we now realize that this, unless there is an significant improvement in efficiency and energy densities and the cycles in lead acid technology or advanced lead acid, lithium ion seems to be more promising. Then you have technologies like hydrogen fuel cells, etc., where you can store a lot of power and discharge it in a couple of hours. On a lithium ion, if we focus, what is the basic technology is making the electrolytes, I mean, anode and cathode. So I don't see any company where we have an advanced stage in India to make anode cathode. Largely anode materials are graphite and lithium titanium oxide. Graphite is a popular material, and we have significant reserves of graphite in India. I mean, graphite India and Bangalore, is doing significantly well because lithium ion is gaining more popularity. So in terms of cost and lifetime, both it is okay, but LTO in terms of cost and lifetime, both it is high, but at the same time, energy density is low. On the cathode material, you have various cathode material. The idea, I mean, I cannot cover what are the various chemistries here, but just to give you in brief as to what are the various technologies used and its application. On a chemistry, then it can take, I think I'll not be allowed to speak more than 10 minutes, so I would not. So LCO, LMO, NMC, LFP, NCA, so let's say these are lithium, cobalt, oxide, manganese. So these are the material used in cathode technologies, and you would see the various energy density. So where the efforts are, the whole idea of efforts which is moving in the battery technology right now is to increase energy density. So from the same weight, you have more watt-hours, so you can use it for the most time, reduce the cost, and increase the lifetime. So if we can achieve all of these three, that will be the chemistry which will look more futuristic. So largely, NMC and NCA are used because they provide a mix of all three in terms of energy density, cost, and lifetime. And the lifetime, I would also say, is dependent on how many cycles of discharge and charge it can take. So that will also be quite important for the lifetime. So these are various technology and their comparison. You would see the LTO efficiencies are very high. They can operate for a longer, I mean, they can operate for a very high temperature range. I mean, it's quite important in India, and that's the reason some of the commercial buses look for an LTO technology, because the ambient temperature could be very high, and that's good if these batteries work at a high ambient temperature with the same amount of efficiency it can. Normally, in battery efficiency figures, what you see from 93% to 97%, these are figures when you are operating the batteries at around 25-27 degrees centigrade. So as the temperature increases, there is a derating, like the way you have all been knowing something similar to your solar panels. Most batteries of this would be with a depth of discharge of 80% define their lifetime. C rate defines how fast you can discharge the battery. So let's say 1 C could be that you can do it in an hour, C by 4 that you can discharge the entire battery in 15 minutes. Cycle life is how many times you can charge and discharge. Most of these batteries are toxic in nature, so we are still talking of battery technology, etc., and where people have actually started working on how do you recycle these batteries. So let's say an example, when it all started 2007-8, when most, or maybe I would say a little before also, 2006-7, when China started making solar panel at a scale 1 gigawatt and above, and 10 such suppliers were given aids from the government to do such a thing, and they were taking all these smaller 200 to 500 megawatts of German supplier and taking that as a scale. So something similar is happening in energy storage market there as well. So right now, if you talk, we have approximately 55% of battery market available in China. They have very promising technologies, and approximately 65% of the entire electric vehicle market is in China. While we are only talking of gigawatt scale factories, gigawatt hour factories to be coming for battery storage in India, they already are at scale where they could be reaching around 180 to 200 gigawatt hours. And there are at least six companies which are planning in somewhere in between 20 to 30, and maybe in future around 50 gigawatt hour kinds of line in 3 to 5 years. We have no gigawatt hour line present in India. And looking at the investment size, I wouldn't say that if you want to make cells in India, unless you're planning a 1 gigawatt hour with an investment size of nearly $150 to $200 million, it doesn't make sense to do a cell production at a capacity of 50 megawatt hours or 100 megawatt hours. You will never be able to achieve that scale, and so is the cost. So when you, I mean, so where we will be still be making energy packs. So I think I've covered some of this on the technology. You would see that with various chemistries, the dimensions to look are how is the specific energy, How is the safety of this? How is the performance, lifespan, and cost? And various technologies have advantage and disadvantage. So just to explain you this chart, I'll just compare NC and NMC. So let's say the specific power, if you take as an example, NMC can accommodate less specific power compared to NCA. And in the same way, NCA is less safe compared to NMC battery. So safety is largely driven by how you are able to separate both the electrolytes, what kind of separator material you use. In any case, are there possibilities that a fire can be there or not? So where we are presently is popular technologies from LCO, NMC, LFPs. Then we are moving towards in 3 to 10 years towards some solid state batteries, high voltage, lithium silicon. And then the other electrolyte, let's use air. So there's only lithium or maybe lithium magnesium and air in this. So 10 years down the line, those chemistries also could be very popular. Now, why do you feel in a renewable market it is so important that we've started seeing where when the parks are coming up in size of 500 megawatt to 1 gigawatt, there'll always be in time of grid outages. Grid is not able to take that power. So and policies are in process where utilities as well as the developers would be asked to put some amount of storage at the plant boundary as well as at the substation. So what are the application if you see in terms of using the energy storage? So first is in renewable integration, where you would see that they can be used for 3 to 4 hours, maybe a couple of seconds as well, but largely in range of 3 to 4 hours where you can supply power from that. So when we spoke about solar wind hybrid systems to increase PLF, or when we spoke about 24/7 renewable, this is an important shift. Then on a consumer side, when demand chain management happen, you have TOD charges, etc. This is an important aspect to look at. Transmission and distribution side, an upgrade to the grid. And on an ancillary services, it does provide support for load shaving, frequency regulation, voltage support. So all that dips. I mean, in Europe, when you are setting up a plant within storage, people are getting incentives for in frequency regulation. In US, you have watched which are synchronized with the frequency, so you can't afford, like in India, we can afford. So that way. What are the market drivers? I mean, renewable integration will not be the most important market driver to this, but electric vehicle adoption would certainly drive the energy storage market. Other things could be telecom towers, diesel replacement in those. Falling prices of PVs and batteries would drive. I mean, the way we are seeing solar energy is available cheaper. At the same time, batteries also, the trend is moving towards $400-$500 kilowatt hours to more prominent figures of 200, sub 200 figures. I mean, in US, people are talking now on a $100 kilowatt hour, this thing. What is that we have done in last 2 years in this? The first project in Andaman Nicobar, 20 megawatt, 28 megawatt hour battery tender by NLC, which is already done. NTPC and Netra unit is coming up. So there are few things which we've already done in this, which are up and running in telecom towers, etc. It's in, people are now moving from lead acid to advanced lead acid or lithium ion. What the proposed thing is largely in SEZs and smart cities. Make a complete solar smart city along with batteries. There are various other government agencies who are coming up with energy storage. Most of these tenders you would be seeing in electric vehicle, but on a utility, and this thing also is coming. So there are still some challenges. Still the cost is high. So the short-term impact of that would be significantly high. The adoption would be lower. So that is one thing. Lack of policy framework. I mean, we still don't have policies. How do we do a robust policy to for adoption of this? And impact of this would be a little bit on the short term, but medium, long term, I think that will be taken care. An improvement in supply and grid reliability. I mean, we don't have suppliers here in India for such a thing. There are a lot of talks where most Indian industrial houses wants to come and set up factories as well as most systems are being talked about now with energy storage, electric vehicle, of course. There are tenders coming now and then. And on a long term, the improvement of supply and grid reliability would be very high if we consider this. Of course, commercial industrial segment remains the most attractive for energy storage because rooftop, people who want to do in 24/7, 100% renewable, RE100 aim, it makes a lot of sense, especially that you have everything covered in that. Happy to take questions. Thank you very much.